Welcome to Murder Mile, a true crime podcast, an audio-guided walk, featuring many of London's untold, unsolved, and long-forgotten murders, all set within and beyond the West End. Today's episode is about one of the most disturbing acts of terrorism to be perpetrated in London's West End. So shocking and violent, it was unlike anything we had seen before. But outside of the victim's loved ones, this tragedy is practically forgotten. Murder Mile is researched using authentic sources. It contains moments of satire, shock, and grisly details. And as a dramatization of the real events, it may also feature loud and realistic sounds, so that no matter where you listen to this podcast, you'll feel like you're actually there. My name is Michael. I am your tour guide, and this is Murder Mile. Episode 133, The Termination of LL Flight 016. Today, I'm standing on Duke Street in Mayfair, W1. Three streets east of the Hyde Park bombing, one street east of the assassination of Alexander Litvinenko, one street south of Elsie Goldsmith's electrical abortion, and one street north of the slaughtered family of Joseph King. Coming soon to Murder Mile. Interconnecting with the bustling shopping splurge of Oxford Street, and running parallel with the overpriced hotels of Park Lane, Duke Street is one of those posh little places which is unremittingly vague. It's almost as if it doesn't want to be remembered for anything. Look up any wall in Mayfair and you'll see a series of plaques commemorating all manner of historical nonsense. As with stately pomp, they proudly declare, here an author sneezed, here an actor breathed, and here a businessman did something good for the poor. So please ignore their sex crimes, their fraud, and their history as a slave trader. On the corner of Grosvenor Square and Duke Street sits the London Marriott Hotel. A colossal, seven-story, five-star hotel, formerly known as the Europa. With fine dining, soft sheets, and its staff trained to cater to our every whim, for many, it's the perfect place to unwind after a long flight to London. Outside on the brick-lined drive is often sat a flank of silver Mercedes, shuttling guests from the airport to the hotel. To make their stay more pleasurable, the second a guest sets foot in the grand entrance, they're greeted by a concierge, given the keys by reception, and their bags are whisked away by the porters. For the crew of LL Flight 016, the Europa was a regular stopover between Heathrow and New York. It was familiar and welcoming. And being tired, they looked forward to a lovely meal and a good night's sleep. But before they could even reach the door, nine lives would be changed forever. The termination of LL Flight 016 was one of the bloodiest acts of terrorism in London's dark history. But there are no memorials to the fallen, no plaques to the survivors, and no statues to the dead. As it was here, on Sunday the 20th of August 1978, at 1:34 p.m, that this peaceful hotel entrance was turned into a bloodbath. But just as quickly as this atrocity had ended, it was forgotten forever. Of the 21 strong crew of LL Flight 016, not one of them was the true target of the terrorists. But when there's a war of words between governments and groups, it's always the innocent who are hurt. On the 28th of September 1948, the inaugural flight of El Al Airlines, Israel's flagship carrier, began in very inauspicious circumstances. With Israel's first president, Chaim Weizmann, due to attend a conference in Switzerland, but blockaded by a travel embargo imposed on the country's military aircraft. An Israeli C-54 transporter carrier was repainted with a fake logo and a made-up name, and flown non-stop from Tel Aviv to Geneva and back again the next day, where it was repainted and returned to military duties. 2 weeks later, El Al Israel Airlines was formed, with the bulk of its acquisition funded by the Israeli government. As a symbol of the Israeli government, El Al Airlines has had many acts of terrorism perpetrated upon it by the PFLP, the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, an anti-Zionist terror group who do not recognize the State of Israel and draw attention to the plight of their occupied lands through hijackings, bombings, and assassinations. 23rd of July 1968, the PFLP hijacked El Al 426, holding 48 hostages for 39 days. 26th of December 1968, two PFLP gunmen opened fire on El Al 253, killing an Israeli mechanic. 18th of February 1969, El Al 432 was attacked, killing the co-pilot and injuring the pilot. September 1970, El Al 219 and El Al 707 were two of four airliners hijacked by the PFLP. 10th of February 1970, a transfer coach was attacked in Zurich, killing one and wounding 11. And 30th of May 1972, 28 passengers were executed at Ben Gurion Airport, the home of El Al Airlines. Because of these acts of terror, El Al is regarded as one of the most secure airlines in the world, being the first to introduce compulsory bag searches, metal detectors, and X-ray scanners. El Al are also the only commercial airline equipped with the Flight Guard anti-missile defense system to protect its planes from surface-to-air missiles. And to ensure the safety of its flight crews abroad, El Al even provides a flank of armed escorts on their transfer buses to and from the airports and the hotels.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your captain speaking. Welcome on board flight LL016, a Boeing 747 out of Newark. The weather is good, and with a flight time of 6.5 hours, we will arrive into London Heathrow at 11:35 a.m. On board are our attendants, Mika Alonga, Yehudi Arnon, Yuli Cohen, and Ivit Gidron. And on behalf of myself and the rest of the crew, I would like to wish you a good flight and thank you for flying El Al Airlines.
With most of the crew in their 20s, many were new, but all were proud to be part of Israel's premier airline. It was a pride reflected in their uniforms, with the stewardesses each looking resplendent in an orange striped blouse, cream-colored heels, a bright orange skirt, and a silk scarf which matched the airline's livery. For many of the crew on board El Al 016, this marked the start of a bright future. But for some, this flight would be their last. By the 1970s, the unrest in Israel had intensified, but many foreign governments still saw this little war as their problem, not ours. Having aligned with the PLO, the Palestinian Liberation Organization, the PFLP and rival terror groups sought to bring their campaign of terror to foreign soil. As wave after wave of bomb blasts brought fear and bloodshed to city after city, until the foreign powers sat up and took notice. One of which was the British government, with a key target for terrorists being London. July to November 1969, bombs explode at Marks and Spencer's stores ran by Teddy and Israel Seif. 15th of December 1971, the Jordanian ambassador is shot in Kensington by Black September. 19th of September 1972, the Israeli Councillor for Agricultural Affairs was killed by a letter bomb sent by Black September, with a further 20 intercepted in Britain and 50 more found in India. 30th of December 1973, Marks and Spencer's boss, Teddy Seif, survived an attempted assassination by Carlos the Jackal on behalf of the PFLP. By the mid to late 1970s, the PFLP had begun firing rocket-propelled grenades at El Al airliners. They had escalated their arsenal of atrocities. The innocent casualties were seen as a forgettable loss in their fight to free the Holy Land. And the hijacking and bombing of airliners had become commonplace.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your captain speaking. The time is 11:35 a.m. and we have arrived on schedule at London Heathrow. On behalf of myself and the flight crew of LL016, we would like to thank you for flying with LL Airlines.
For the passengers, it was an uneventful flight. They ate, they slept, and the worst they would experience would be a lost bag or a bit of jet lag. The Boeing 747 was cleaned, it was refueled, and a new crew boarded this return flight to Newark, as LL Flight 016 was terminated. For their exhausted crew of 21 men and women, this would be a regular stopover in a familiar city at a hotel their company had a long-standing contract with. With their next flight scheduled for the next morning, the turnaround would be tight, but there would still be a little time for fun. At 12:40 p.m. on Sunday the 20th of August 1978, they boarded a transfer bus at Terminal 3. Security at UK airports by the late 1970s was lax. X-ray scanners weren't mandatory. Passengers were only routinely checked with a magnetometer, a low-level detector capable of sensing only large metal objects. And it wasn't until 1986 that passengers were first questioned on the contents of their bags. In the first week of August 1978, 22-year-old Farhad Mahi flew into Heathrow from Tel Aviv. With big bushy hair, a tight brown beard, an intense stare, and a demeanour described as ice cool, although little is known about his history, his passport was clean and his entry into the country was approved. Waved through security, Farhad collected his suitcase from the carousel, which contained a set of nondescript casual clothes, as well as the tools of his trade. Two submachine guns, believed to be the Carlo, an inferior replica of the Israeli-made Uzi 9mm, compact enough to hide inside a jacket and capable of firing 400 rounds a minute, as well as a nest of M26 grenades, fitted with a 4.4-second fuse and a kill radius of 5 to 15 meters, with its shrapnel able to inflict serious damage up to 230 meters away. His accomplice was never identified. What we do know was that he was late 20s, 5'6", with protruding front teeth, a Mexican-style moustache, and a sallow complexion. And although some witnesses later claimed that there were two more assailants, we know it was these two who unleashed one of the bloodiest acts of terrorism in London's dark history. Because one of them was sent to prison, and the other was sent to the morgue.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome on board this Gold Eagle coach to Mayfair. My name is Ron Stagg. I'll be driving you in a Cave Edge Bedford van. But only because your Boeing 747 is too wide for Duke Street. And the Europa Hotel aren't best pleased about having a jet parked on the drive. The weather is currently fine, but being Britain, it'll probably be piddling down by the time we get anywhere nice. Thank you for flying with Gold Eagle coaches. Not that you had much choice.
Across the next 50 minutes, the half-full 55-seater bus drove along the A40 from Heathrow to Victoria. As a relatively new coach, the full aspect windows were large and clear. The metalwork gleamed brightly in the sunlight, and down the length of its sides were stylish red flashes and wood panelling. Inside, the flight crew of LL016 were upbeat, with their chat concerning their plans for the evening. What type of food to eat, where to go for a drink, and whether they could catch Annie or Evita at the theatre, or Saturday Night Fever, or Close Encounters of the Third Kind at the cinema. And although, over the last decade, atrocities against Israeli targets had surged on London streets, on board were an LL security escort to provide protection, even if legally they couldn't be armed. At 1:32 p.m. precisely, the coach pulled onto Park Lane on the eastern edge of Hyde Park. Turning left onto Upper Brook Street, the engine growled as it gently cruised past the US Embassy. Its indicator clicked as the wheels steered left, and rounding the corner, the coach crawled onto Duke Street. Being too big to fit on the drive of the Europa, which was already busy as a black cab idled awaiting a fare, and an excitable wedding party milled around reception, the bus parked up parallel to the hotel, with the front passenger door facing George Yard and the rear luggage bay facing Grosvenor Square. Inside, the crew collected their hand luggage, and although they were off duty, as representatives of the airline, they straightened their caps, adjusted their ties, and brushed away any creases, so they could exit the coach with a sense of elegance and pride. Watched by the wedding guests, the cab driver, and the drinkers at the Barley Mow pub, just 20 feet away, the crew were something to behold, as there's always something impressive about a person in uniform. As the crew disembarked, the engine was cut, and the driver opened the rear boot where the aircrew's luggage was stored. Like a well-oiled machine, the concierge greeted his guests, reception prepared their room keys, and a ready line of porters stood ready to do their duty. For the flight crew of LL016, this was the end of another day. But for one of the crew, it would be the end of her life. The time was 1:34 p.m. As Yuli Cohen stood by, she spotted two men approach from the front and rear of the coach. To her right, on the corner of Grosvenor Square, was an Arab with a Mexican moustache and protruding teeth. To her left, on George Yard, was a second, with fuzzy dark hair, who glared at the flight crew with hateful rage. Sensing the danger, Yuli stuttered to her supervisor, "I think he's going to start shooting at us." But by then, it was too late. Just as Irid Gidron pulled her back from the boot, the assassins unleashed hell. Like hard, fast cracks of thunder, gunfire echoed off the walls as fierce flashes of fire erupted from their submachine guns. As the two men sprayed the coach and its human cargo with bullets. With 32 rounds in each magazine, having emptied the first clip in 5 seconds flat, they loaded a second, then a third, and then a fourth. In panic, terrified wedding guests dived inside the hotel lobby. Pub guests dived for cover, and the air crew scattered as hot black rain sprayed far and wide, smashing glass and ricocheting off walls. Richard Aldridge, a chauffeur, later said, "Suddenly, a man ran along the side of the coach. Somebody inside closed the doors, and the man started firing. All hell broke loose. It was terrifying. Bullets riddled every door, wall, or window. Guests, aircrew, and passers-by alike. It didn't matter who they killed, as this was a numbers game. The target was Israel, but the more they could kill, the greater their glory." Thinking fast, Yuli ran for cover behind a parked car as she dragged a Yehudi to safety. A volley of fiery bullets had ripped through the stewardess's pale legs, snapping her bones like toothpicks. And as Yehudi drifted in and out of consciousness, a river of blood pooled as her orange skirt spread with red. Yuli called out to her colleagues. Some had got to safety, some had not, and one was entirely still. Julian Harris, who lived across the street, later stated, there were bodies and blood everywhere. And although the casualty list was climbing, the assassins were far from finished. From the black canvas sacks strung across their chests, they pulled a nest of M26 fragmentation grenades. With a kill radius of up to 15 meters, and its shrapnel able to maim as far as 230 meters away. Accuracy was not essential, as this was a maximum casualty weapon. Harry Kane, a porter, later said, I saw one bomb land under the taxi and explode. Having hid inside his cab when the shooting began, although bullets had peppered the black panels, the grenade blast blew the taxi driver clear out of his seat as the bloodied man slumped onto the drive in a crumpled heap. Witnesses later stated, the grenades seemed to fall from everywhere. A second hit the glass of the Europa, spraying the staff with shards of flying glass, and the wedding guests were hit with hard steel splinters. Jim Murray, a pub manager, later said of Farhad, He stood pulling grenades from a haversack and lobbing them at the bus. He was just taking them out and throwing it. God, he was ice cool. As a third grenade exploded, shrapnel struck Yuli in the arm. Johan de Plessis, a guest, later stated, one of the hostesses had been blasted. I tried to help her as she lay there, but already she looked dead. And although Yuli was hurt, Yehudi was bleeding to death as a bullet had struck her in the head. Whereas the last grenade remains a mystery. Maybe Farhad caught his cohort in the crossfire. Maybe it went off by mistake. Maybe he was shot by the supposedly unarmed LL escorts. Or perhaps, having mistimed its 4.4 second fuse, the maniac with a Mexican mustache failed to throw it fast enough and felt the full force of the blast in his face. Either way, as Farr had fled. His unknown assailant lay dead. Three police officers wrestled Farr to the ground, and he was swiftly arrested. In total, the assassins' bullets and bombs had wounded 9 and killed 1, in an attack which lasted less than 2 minutes. Of the 4 flight crew of LL-016 who were hit, Mikael Unger's injuries were listed as not serious. Yuli Cohen escaped with a shrapnel scar, and 23-year-old Yehudi Arnon, who was just weeks away from getting married, was listed as critical, had a bullet removed from her brain, and amazingly, she survived. But one of the crew had not. Having left the coach to collect her bag, 29-year-old Irit Gidron was hit by the first wave of bullets. Turning to face the gunfire coming from Grosvenor Square, it's likely that she died before she even knew what was happening. As an eyewitness would later recall, she was lying at the rear of the coach, all still and silent, with the back of her head entirely blown out. The British government expressed its deepest sympathy. The Israeli Prime Minister called it a barbarous crime. The PFLP took full credit for the act. And the next day, Israeli fighter jets bombed a Palestinian camp just south of Beirut, killing 3 and injuring 14, in a pointless tit-for-tat of violent retaliation. Farhad Mihi was tried at the Old Bailey on the 28th of January 1979. On the 8th of June 1979, he was found guilty of murder, attempted murder, and explosives and weapons charges. And for that, he was given 4 life sentences. He is currently 65 years old and is an inmate at Dartmoor Prison. 2 days after the attack, the body of Irit Gidron was flown back to Israel. As a mark of respect, she was buried near the 11 Israeli athletes who were killed in the 1972 Munich Olympics massacre. And although a memorial service is held in Haifa every year, Yuli still finds it too painful to attend. The crew of LL Flight 016 were just good people doing their jobs and living their lives, who were used as pawns in a political tug of war. 40 years on, there are still no memorials to the dead, and at least in this country, the events are mostly forgotten. But why? Perhaps it could be blamed on politics, on the deluge of devastation that the 1970s brought, on our desensitization to the violence we consume in the media. Or maybe it's as simple as this. A plaque might have been put in place had the victims of the attack been British. But as this tragedy is all but forgotten, for now, this episode will have to stand as the memorial to the crew of LL-016. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for listening to Murder Mile. If you enjoyed that, and you enjoy cake chat, tea twaddle, and extra details about the case, there will be more after the break. But I warn you now, it's waffly bullshit. So if that's not your thing, switch off now. But before that, here's a true crime podcast, which may very well be the equivalent of a handy megaphone for a mouthy coot.
Oh, hey there. You like true crime stories, right? Yeah, I know, who doesn't? But I gotta admit, after a while, all those stories of murder and heartache, well, they tend to go straight to my hips. So that's why I, Leroy Luna, I've created a podcast called Excuse Me, That's Illegal, where we'll take a hardcore look at some softcore crimes. No TED Talks on Bundy here. The letters BTK won't be coming from these lips. Unless he had a brother that used to steal library books. Suppose I'd be willing to go balls deep into that one if that were the case. Anyways, you'll hear stories such as the Mad Pooper, a female jogger who wreaked havoc in a Colorado Springs neighborhood, using one family's front yard as her own personal dumping grounds. If this kind of content sounds like it's up your alley, excuse me, that's illegal. It's available right now on all your favorite podcatchers. So come join me.
I'll be right here waiting for you.
A big thank you to my new Patreon supporters, who are Kaylee Groom, Sharon Bennett, Lydia Pappas, and Rachel Tester. I thank you all. You are now part of a very exclusive club, and unlike half of the members' clubs in Soho, it's not full of arseholes. With a thank you to two very kind anonymous donations which came in via the supporter link. Whoever you are, I thank you. And as always, a big thank you to you. Yes, you. Your continued audio appreciation of the podcast is very much appreciated. Murder Mile is researched, written and performed by myself, with the main musical themes written and performed by Eric Stein and John Books of Cult With No Name. Thank you for listening. And sleep well.
Huzzah! That was that done. I always keep meaning to do it. I'm going to get rid of my pop shield here. Just get that out of the way for a second. I always keep meaning at the end to do a little piss take of... You know, when you listen to all these podcasts where Joe, it sounds like it's one person, but when you listen to the credits at the end, it's always someone going, it was researched by this person, it was written by this person, the audio was done, the music was done, and they go through a list, or especially all these podcasts by Wondery, and they're always like, you know, it sounds like you think to yourself one person's done it, but they haven't, there's a big team of them. And I keep meaning to do a piss take about that. You know, there's one podcast out there, I won't name it, and they list everyone. They list like the runner who's on there, the person who made the tea, and I'm desperate to do an end version for mine where you go, the tea was made by me. That's why I like having that little line at the end which goes, written, researched and performed by myself, because it is, all this is done by me. Every single word of every single episode is written by me, researched by me, and that is never going to change. You will never, ever hear me have someone else write an episode or research an episode of Murder Mile. I just don't think it can be done. I really don't. I know some people do, but I personally think to myself, if you create a podcast, you're creating something that's unique and yours, and you have to put your... What makes podcasts interesting is that you put yourself into it. You know, your tone, your ideas, the way you think about things. And the day that you start handing it away to other people, it stops being yours. I used to enjoy listening to Case File, but Case File's the same. Everything's outsourced now, and it's just like the second you outsource it, it stops being yours. It just becomes generic. So, Murder Mile is never going to change. It's always going to be mine. I think that's the thing. I don't think it's not easy to write. I used to do some work for BBC Radio Wales years ago, and the thing that's interesting when you're writing questions for radio presenters and people like that is you've got to work out their tone, and that's the hard thing. Is not just writing questions, is working out what it is that the audience sees in that person, and what they know that person would say. If you just write them a question, it won't work. And that's why podcasts have to be their voice. You've got to get the voice. Oh dear. Anyway. Welcome everyone. Welcome to Extra Mile. If your first time here, this is the unedited, unscripted bit. This is not the same as the first bit. That you've listened to the show already. That's done. Right, this is the extra bit. This is like if you pick up a DVD, this is like the audio commentary. This is like the behind the scenes stuff. Yeah, this is not part of the show. So you don't have to listen to this. You can switch off now. Not a problem at all. Thank you for listening. Goodbye. Everyone else, I'm going to open a window. Oh, it's a bit meaty in here. Nice and quiet out today. Not too bad. I've moved again. I'm just going to make a cup of tea, a cup of coffee. Let's do a cup of coffee. As always, instant coffee. Yeah, I can't, do you know what, I can't be arsed with alleged posh coffee because I sometimes find it too strong. I also get quite annoyed because even when you filter it out, you still got all the black bits. You know, all the little bits that are kind of hidden away at the bottom, and I hate all that. So, yeah, I'm happy with instant. You know, stick to what you know. Stick to what you know.
What else we got?
Yeah, I moved somewhere else. It's very nice. I'm on a bit, it's very remote where I am, but it's very quiet, but it's all right. You don't get too many people going past. The posh airport is a little bit further away, so you don't get all the bellends going, "Oh, I'm going to a business meeting. I need to fly from a remote airport to another remote airport, and then the driver's going to pick me up and then drive me to my meeting. And then when I get to the meeting, I'm going to say to everyone, I've just arrived in my private aircraft." And everyone's going to go, "Well, bully for you. What bullshit." But no, it's all right. It's quite nice here. I've got a fisherman who's right outside my back door. But that sounded like a euphemism. It's not. He's right outside there. It's very nice. I think a secret to living on the waterway is get to know your fishermen. Because the great thing is they're there from morning till night. And as long as you get chatting to them, they seem like decent people. And when you look at their equipment, they've got a lot of equipment that A, they don't want to leave. There's a couple of £1,000 worth of rods and kit. They don't want to leave it. You know, and they're outside your door all day. So, you know, they're kind of, who's going to break into your boat when you're outside the door? Exactly. No cake today. I didn't pick one up at the shops yesterday, but I did pick up a Diet Mars bar. Yeah, Diet Mars bar. Oh, suitable for vegetarians. Yeah, flaky people. There's no instructions on it, but it says it's a Mars bar. It's like, it's not even a trial size Mars bar. It's basically a very, very thin one. It's the size, literally the size of a finger, width and length of a finger, and it's 95 calories. But it's 95 calories because it's tiny. Well done, Mars bar. You just said, "Oh, this is a diet version. We're just going to make it smaller." It's like, remember when the trial size Diet Cokes came out? Anyone who picked up one of those, I just wanted to slap them because that was like, it's not even a mouthful. Anyway, right. What else we got? We're going through the season now. We're all doing very well. After this episode, we've got one more episode to go, which will be next week. And then, because I need time to catch up with research and to do the next burst of kind of episodes, but also to give me a chance to go and see my dad, there will be three episodes coming out. I'm not too sure. I've researched three types, and there might be three other ones that I might do if I get a chance to record them, or they may come out in October. But either way, that's all going to go well. My coffee is about to go. I hope I put water in. See, that's the beautiful thing. That's the beautiful thing about having instant coffee. None of this bullshit. It's like none of it putting it in a cafetiere and then waiting and then having to plunger it down and then clean it out. You just put it in a mug, a nice Murderwell mug, and then you have your coffee. One of the things I love as well is that a bird's custard you can get in an instant pack, which is great. Oh, gone are the old days where you have to put in the custard powder and then you have to crush up the sugar to, otherwise it makes it lumpy, and then you have to get the milk nice and hot. Now you just add water. Oh, I've had apple pie and custard every night. How's the diet going? Yeah, it's going great. What else is going on? All going good. So hopefully in about 2 weeks I get to see my dad and my stepmom, which would be good because I have not seen them in 2.5 years now. That'll be nice. I hope we recognise each other. That'll be good. Hopefully, I'm going to go and see my good friend, Mr. Richard. His name's not Mr. Richard. I was about to say his surname then, but I realised I probably shouldn't. So I'm going to go and see Rich. Hopefully, that'll be good. And I've already just been to see my brother, which was good. It was his 50th birthday, and we did him a surprise 50th birthday party, even though he worked out he was going to have a surprise party because one of his sons started cleaning. And he was like, "Why is Will cleaning?" And it's like, "Oh shit, we got people turning up. He only cleans when people turn up." So he knew something was going on anyway. So, but that was nice. But it was weird being in a house full of a socially distanced house full of, like, I'm used to like one other person, and this was extra people. So yeah, we did it in a garden, and it was all safe and all that. So that was good, but weird. things we're going to have to get used to again. And, of course, Murder Mile Walks restart at the end of June. As mentioned before, I won't be doing any private talks, private walks for the foreseeable future. But I've had my first vaccine. I've got my second one in July. And I've got regular lateral flow tests. So I'm going to be regularly testing myself on a regular basis every single week to make sure that when I do the walks, they will be safe. But also, I'm not going to fill it full of people. It's just going to be, as before, maximum 15, evenly spaced. And I'll be wearing my mask throughout, except for the talky bit. Because I realise that's too difficult. Right, let's do quiz questions. As always, some of these may not appear in the final episode, and that's because what you've just listened to is an edited episode, which has taken me 3 days to edit. But this bit I'm recording now, having just recorded it, but I haven't edited it yet, so I don't know what I'm going to take out. But of course, if you're a Patreon subscriber and you get the Walk With Me episodes, you know all about that. Because I give you all the secrets, because I record that after I've edited. So you get all the secrets, you get all the bits that didn't make it into the episode, and you get all the kind of all the extra stuff that I couldn't tell you when during this bit. So that's worth subscribing to. That's literally, what, £5 a month, and you get lots of goodies for that. Right, let's do some quiz questions. Let's dive in. So, question number one. Ooh, that Mars bar looks good. Question number one. Oh, sod it. Let's have it. Oh, look at that. Oh, a little finger of chocolate. The good thing is the chocolate, it's tiny, but the chocolate is still thick. Mm. Oh, yeah. Good times. And Mars bar goes lovely with a nice hot chocolate. Question number one. What was the name of the pub which was nearest to the hotel? And it's still there today. Although when I went there, it was boarded up, which is a real pain. What was the name of the pub that was nearest to the hotel? Question number two. What type of submachine gun did both men carry? Question number three. Which airport did LL016 fly from? Question number four. Which terminal at Heathrow did LL016 fly into? Not into as in crash, as in nicely. Question five. Which two terrorist attacks mentioned in the episode, which I might have edited out, featured Carlos the Jackal? Question six. Name the bus driver. Ooh, that's a hard one. Question seven. LL Airlines was formed when Israel's first president was going where? A place name would be good for that. Question eight. LL is the only commercial airliner equipped with what? Question nine. This is an easy one. The Europa is on what street? And to top it all off, question 10. This is a hard one. How many seats, excluding the driver, were on the coach? There you go. Let's dive into some details about the case. So, Farhad Mihi, we don't really know actually that much about him, to be honest. Unfortunately, the case file for this is in the archives, but it's held for many years. I think there's a lot of politics involved around this one, which I'll dive into very shortly. So, around the time, we knew he was 22 years old. He had large fuzzy hair, tight beard, brown hair, brown eyes, a very intense stare. He was described as angry, merciless, but calm under fire, as we've seen in the episode. Pretty much most of his back history is unknown, but he clearly knew how to use submachine guns and grenades. It is believed he was either military or guerrilla trained. When he was in court, he said that his parents had been killed by Israelis, hence his anger. In court as well, he said that he had no knowledge of the second man, this unidentified other assassin. And even though there was allegedly two or three other assassins involved, he denied any knowledge of those, and he's remained by that word since. So he said it was just him in the attack. He was described 5'7", well built, long black curly bushy hair with a thick moustache. as mentioned, wearing green corduroy trousers, multicoloured sweatshirt and green training shoes. So as you can see, they're kind of very normally dressed. He was holding a haversack with grenades and a submachine gun, which I will not say what type. His English was limited and he was described by those who saw him as ice cool. As for the terrorist, if you go to Patreon, I've uploaded some photos there and you will see one of the terrorists dead on the floor. Not one of them, that one, the one that we don't know about. He died at the scene. He was described as about 30, 5'6" of slim build. He had protruding front teeth and black hair, wearing a blue shirt, black trousers and white striped shoes. As mentioned, a Mexican style moustache with a sallow complexion, and he had about 3 to 4 days stubble. There was also possibly 3 or 4 others, but they're still unknown whether there was a getaway driver. There's a lot about this case, which is, even though it's wrapped up, there's a lot that really we don't know a lot about. As mentioned, the bus was by Gold Eagle Coaches, which was they had a regular contract with LL Airlines. As they did with the Europa Hotel. So this has been a long-standing thing. As mentioned before, London had been a bit of a hotspot for terrorism, especially against Israeli targets. Hence, there was LL armed security. Well, there was LL security on the coach, and this is where things get a little bit difficult. So, LL security were on the coach. Where's this bit that I wanted to read you? 1979, so 1 year later, British officials said they had again turned down an Israeli request for LL security guards to be allowed to carry guns in London. So that states that they were unarmed. Which makes sense, you know, if you're a country, you can't allow other countries to walk around with their own guns in a country where we don't have guns. You know, you have to have a special license. We're a civilized country, thank you very much. We used to have people walking around with guns whenever they felt like it, but not in this country, and we expect that of other people as well. But there are reports that the armed security on board returned fire. But see, a lot of this information is really, it's a bit sketchy. And LL said that their security were unarmed, but if you can appreciate that, they wouldn't want it to be announced that if their security was alarmed, A, they were breaking the rules of our country, which goes against, you know, our rules, sorry. But then they would have to admit that they had killed a Palestinian terrorist, which would cause serious ramifications against LL Airlines. So you can understand why they would say, well, our security guards weren't armed, because that kind of breaks two rules there. So, but some people said that the LL security did return fire. Unfortunately, there's no footage of the event. There's no cameras. Do you know, there's a couple of pictures afterwards, immediately afterwards, but there's nothing of this moment itself. So with the terrorist himself, the unknown one, that's why we don't really know a lot about. There was definitely 4 grenades that were thrown, and we know where the grenades landed, because obviously there's kind of a bit of an impact crater and some shrapnel, and, you know, we're able to see that. The 4th grenade is the one that's a little bit baffling. The 4th grenade is the one that blew up the terrorist himself, and we still don't know why, what happened there. Either Fahad threw a grenade and it landed near his friend and then blew him up, because his friend seemed to be running around, like he was the one who was running along the side of the bus and shooting people. But Farhad was very calm, and he kind of stood on George Yard and was spraying his gun, and then he walked away. The other terrorist was the one who just seems to be all over the shop. So we don't know whether he walked in front of one of Farhad's bombs, grenades that were thrown, or whether, because it's got like a 4.4 second fuse, maybe it went off too early, maybe he mistimed it, we don't know. But either way, the grenade exploded either close to him or near him. On the photo, it doesn't show his hand, so surely that would have blown up. He's lying on the ground and he's really badly injured. He's not horrible, but, you know, he's clearly dead, which is a good thing. So we don't know about that. That's a bit of a mystery. As mentioned, there was a wedding party there that evening. It was a Jewish wedding. The reception was being held at the Europa. The newlywed couple were Angela Hyman and Andrew White, and they had 200 guests who were there. The reception did take place after the event, at which they paid tribute to the victims. That must have been hard to do. Kind of you've had your happy day. You got married. You're about to relax and do your reception, and then there's a massive terrorist attack outside. The taxi driver who was parked up outside the Europa, he was never identified, but he was the one. His taxi was shot up with kind of bullets that were spraying everywhere. One of the tyres went flat. The sides were peppered with bullets, but he was entirely blown out of his cab. Unfortunately, we don't know much about him. There was a lot of people who, because this is a terrorist incident, they obviously asked the press not to give out their details at all. So there's a lot of people whose injuries we don't know about, various details, things like that. So immediately after the event, armed police and dog handlers flooded the scene. The streets were sealed off. But by this point, Farhad had already been arrested. I think I've got it in here. We can get to it very shortly. So there was a police car actually literally one street away when the attack was happened. They were coming towards the street at the time, and it said a police car screamed down the wrong way of a one-way street after an Arab who was running. Three police officers jumped out of the car and pounced on the Arab, who was shouting, screaming and kicking. They managed to handcuff him and take him away. He was taken away to West End Central, which is unfortunately no longer used, but it's the local police station, literally like two streets away. This is where things get weird. Alan Fikin, 20-year-old hotel chef, said after the shooting, several men ran into the kitchen and tried to get into chef's uniforms, but for some reason they didn't, and they ran out again. See, there's some people who said there were three assassins and others who said there was four. There may have been two assassins who were the ones that we saw. There may have been a watcher. There may have been a getaway driver. We don't know. So there's a lot about this case that's really unknown. In total, nine people were taken to the Middlesex Hospital. That's over in Fitzrovia. Five of the wounded underwent operations that night. One of the hostesses, Yehudi, was in critical condition, and her chances of survival were slender. The other hostesses suffered two machine gun wounds, but were expected to pull through. As mentioned, Irid Gidron, who was 29, she was fatally killed that day, literally at the very start of the attack. Yehudi Arnon was still in critical condition by the Monday the next day, and she had a bullet removed from her brain. Her parents were flown from Israel to be with her. She was 22. She was due to be married in a couple of weeks. She was hit in the head and the leg. By the 28th of September, so almost a month later, she was in hospital doing better, but she was still very weak. She was able to leave London 10 days after that. She flew back to Israel. I don't know much more about her after that. What else we got? As mentioned, immediately after the attack, they were trying to find out where the terrorists had been staying. They'd obviously taken up residence in a hotel or a boarding house or somewhere for the last 17 days, because they knew that they'd been in the UK for at least a week. But as far as I know, because I haven't got the police file, it wasn't announced in the press whether they'd found it or not. It appears that they hadn't. But the police were saying, given the fact that they'd been here 2 weeks, and given the fact that all that they had on them was some clothes and their guns and their the grenades, surely their luggage would be elsewhere. So they were looking for a guest house or something where there was luggage and, you know, a bill hadn't been paid or something like that. Slurp of coffee. There we go. What else we got? Yeah, as mentioned, immediately the next day, Israeli planes attacked two Palestinian centres in Lebanon at the dawn, in retaliation for the grenade and submachine attack on the Israeli airline bus. So it was less than 24 hours. Three guerrillas were killed and 14 were wounded at a Palestinian camp just south of Beirut. Some reports say that this was a refugee camp. Others report that this was a military training camp. Some reports say that it was a children's school, although it was a dawn strike, so the school was actually empty at the moment. Some even say that the day school was used as a guerrilla training camp for boys aged 9 to 13 years old. So, you know, even things like this, there's still kind of anger and kind of, you know, lies being twisted and turned around. We've got the Home Office statements here. Yeah, I won't really go into that because, you know, the words that come out of any politician's mouth is usually bullshit. And they will say any old shit, and you know full well that the second it's come out of their mouth, they've forgotten it and they've moved on to anything else. And that normally involves filling their pockets full of money or getting contracts for their buddies. We've seen a lot of that in Britain recently, haven't we? Oh, joy. Who's going to be the best company to be able to fulfil this order? I know, I've got a friend and he has some spare time on his hands and he would love a couple of million pounds. There we go. That's the way things are done in this country. Interestingly, Israel did not seek the extradition of Fahad. They could have done, given the fact that he was an Israeli, but they didn't. So he remains in the UK. Oh, okay, this is what I wanted. There was a remand hearing at Marlborough Street Magistrates Court, which is in Soho, on the 23rd of August 1978. Fahad had threatened the magistrates. He'd thumped his handcuffed fist on the dock and shouted, "If I am not released, we are going to hit your various interests inside and outside this country." I mean, that's threatening your various interests. My various interests are cake and Eva Green. He'd best not hurt them, otherwise he's dead. The magistrate sent him back to prison. Asked by stipend magistrate David Hopkin whether he had anything to say, Fahad said, "If you don't release me, something will happen to you that won't be good." The judge asked, "Is that a formal application for bail or is it a threat?" Fahad said, "It's a threat," through an interpreter. I quite like that because the judge is clearly not taking him very seriously. There was an inquest, a coroner's inquest held at the Westminster Coroner's Court, 23rd of August 1978, into the murder of Irit Gidron. Professor Keith Simpson said that the death was caused by multiple bullet wounds to the head and chest. It looks, as mentioned, looked like she was getting her bags out of the coach. Her back was to Grosvenor Square. She turned to see what the sound was, and then that's when she got hit. So it looks like she pretty much died instantly. Trial was held at the Old Bailey, 28th of April 1979. There was lots of police guards. There was even snipers on the roof. Because if you go back to the earlier episode of one of episodes of Murder Mile, the attempted assassination of Abd al-Razak Saeed al-Naif. You're welcome. I can still learn how to say that. That was the one, the bungled assassination. This was actually about a year later. A motorbike went past with two guys on it. One of them pulled out a submachine gun and murdered the ex-Iraqi prime minister outside. I think it was the Park Lane Hotel. So this was actually that case at that point. So in the Old Bailey, they had two, they'd terrorist act and an assassination in the building at the same time. So there's a lot of security going on at that point. What else? Yep, he was sentenced to four life sentences to be served concurrently, so he's never going to be released. There's a documentary out there. I've only had a chance to watch bits of it. I haven't got to watch a lot of it. But Yuli Cohen, who was one of the flight attendants who was injured in the attack, she made a documentary back in 2002 called My Terrorist. And kind of over the years, she's, you know, obviously you can appreciate, not only was she was physically injured, but it's kind of the emotional impact of that whole event. She's kind of, you know, it's taken a lot of, she's really struggled a lot with this. So she made a documentary called My Terrorist, where she kind of looks into the kind of relationship between, you know, the Israelis and the Palestinians and kind of terrorism, things like that. And she even she got a chance to go to Broadmoor to meet with Fahed Mihi, the terrorist himself. So I've never seen it, but you can watch it online. So well, you can watch bits of it online. I haven't been able to watch all of it, but yeah, I think that's it. Let's do the questions. Oh, look, I've still got a bit of Mars bar left. Yummy, yeah. Yummy. Yummy, yummy, yummy. I'm going to do a new podcast called Yummy, 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 where I just eat things. And that's it, which is basically this episode. Right, let's do this. Whew. Right, question number one. What was the name of the pub which was nearest to the hotel? It was the Barley Mow. Question number two. What type of submachine gun did both men carry? It was called the Carlo. Carlo is basically, it's an inferior replica of the Uzi 9mm, which is kind of a very small, compact submachine gun. These were handmade. They're kind of popular with the kind of Israeli gangs that are out there. As mentioned, they do like 400 rounds a minute. You can empty a clip in about 5 seconds. It's 32 rounds per magazine. But the problem is, because they're inferior, they have a tendency to jam. Not jam as in, but, you know, shit jam. Not jam as in put it on your bread either. Question three. Which airport did LL016 fly from? It was from Newark. Question four. Which terminal at Heathrow did LL016 fly into? That was Terminal 3. Question 5. Which two terrorist attacks mentioned in the episode feature Carlos the Jackal? That was the attempted assassination of Teddy Seif and the rocket grenade attack at Orly Airport. If you remember, that was the one where they fired two rocket-propelled grenades at an aircraft and they missed it both times and hit an empty building and a car that wasn't being used. And then they blew out the back of their windscreen because they're dickheads. Question 6. Name the bus driver. His name was Ron Stagg. Question 7. LL Airlines was formed when Israel's first president was going where? He was going to Geneva in Sweden. Sweden? Switzerland. It's written there, Switzerland, and I said Sweden for no reason. Question 8. LL is the only commercial airliner equipped with what? It's the Flight Guard Anti-Missile Defence System. Very nice to know that. Question 9, an easy one. Which the Europa Hotel is on what street? That's Duke Street. And question 10, this is a difficult one. How many seats, excluding the driver, were on the coach? It's 55. Lovely jubbly. There we go. Just to say, if you're on Patreon as well, I've uploaded some extra videos as well. So you've got the location video that I filmed, but I've also found some other interesting videos that you might quite like as well. There's some kind of footage of the aftermath of the attack. You see the bus in situ. You see the stewardesses all and flight crew all being taken back to Heathrow and flown back to Israel. There's also kind of Irit's coffin being taken back to Haifa, and, you know, that's quite sad to see as well. So there's a lot on there. So if you want to, ladies and gentlemen, you can subscribe to Murder Mile, the Patreon account on there, which is all very exciting, and you get loads of goodies every week. And even better, you get to support Murder Mile, which is fantastic, and help keep a small independent podcast alive. Not like these big fat podcasts from Wondery, who earn an absolute fortune. Hence, they can have big teams. Yeah. Anyway, that's me done. Hope you enjoyed that. That was all good fun. I shall see you all next week for next week's episode, which is a secret. Whoa! I thought I was going to give it away then. Right, I'm going to finish my Mars bar and I'm going to have my coffee. Have yourself a good weevening. Weevening. Maybe a weevening is a kind of evening where you either weave or wee. Who knows? Anyway, have yourself a good week. Stay safe. Be good. Lots of love. Bye-bye.